Welcome to part two of the Biofumigation and Cover Crops webinar. This webinar is brought to you by the Optimising Cover Crops for the Vegetable Industry project and funded by Horticulture Innovation together with Vegetable Growers Levy Money. In part one, we covered off on the growth of biofumigant cover crops, largely brassicas, in the warm parts of the country, particularly Gatton and Bundaberg. And you can look back on the part one of the video to see how well they grew, and also the levels of glucosinolates in the foliage and roots. In part two, we're going to focus on the sort of pests and diseases that we observed on the crops as they grew. And as you can imagine, that's an important consideration when growing cover crops to try and avoid some cover crops that may be prone to a certain pest or disease. So that's helpful information. That'll take us through a few slides, and then finally John will finish up by summarising some of the early indications on the impact of the biofumigants on three key soil-borne diseases, namely the charcoal rot, the sclerotinia rot, and the sclerodium rot. So those three diseases, those three key soil-borne diseases which affect a large number of vegetables, we'll have a look at what impact the different biofumigants had on the levels in the soil. So that will be what we'll cover in part two. Thank you.
So as I was about to touch on before we had all these questions come in, they do get a lot of pests and diseases. Now, this is just some of the more serious ones that you're quite likely to get. This cabbage cluster caterpillar, as you can see, if you do nothing, you will get nothing. They decimate the crops very quickly. They produce a lot of caterpillars at a time, and they're very ravenous, as you can see. This is a trial that we had up in Bundaberg over summer. And unfortunately, these caterpillars got away on us very quickly, and we had to replant that whole trial. Diamondback moth is another one. And everyone asks me about if you're trying to implement a resistance management strategy for diamondback moth because of the difficulty in managing that particular pest with chemicals. They do harbor diamondback moths. And I'll show you a chart later as to how bad, depending on variety. They can cause a lot of damage on the foliage. They don't strip it like the cabbage cluster caterpillar can do, but they will damage a lot of the foliage. And the more damage you get, the less material you're going to have, the less glucosinolates that are actually going to be produced. But at the same time, if you don't spray them and just leave them there, they can also be a reservoir for your beneficial insects. So your parasitic wasps, your lady beetles and the like that will feed on insects within the crop. And the other one, which I just wanted to mention, is cabbage center grub. We get that more up in Queensland than southern states. It'll get into the growing tip, eat it out, and then the plant will actually branch out and produce more shoots. So that's probably more a friendlier caterpillar than the other two. It can actually help produce more shoots and possibly more glucosinolates. Other chewing pests, the big one we've seen a lot of is flea beetles. They'll attack the plant basically as soon as it comes out of the ground. It doesn't matter what variety, most varieties seem to be attacked by it, but because these are very fast growing plants, they tend to grow out of it. But you can still get a lot of activity in older leaves. As you can see, it's just small pinprick holes on the leaves. Red shoulder beetles is another one which is a sporadic pest. It'll come in and plague proportions. And if you don't look out for it, it can quickly desiccate your crop. And a minor one, pardon the pun, is leaf miner, which you do tend to find more on older leaves. Sucking pests, you will also get different varieties, we'll get it at different levels. Aphids, whitefly, thrips, and even rutherglen bugs. This is very similar to your red shoulder beetle. It'll come in plague proportions from time to time. And as you can see, it sucks the midrib and you get a whole part of the leaf actually dying because there's no nutrients or water getting to that part of the plant. So what we're trying to do with looking at varieties, looking at pests and diseases, we're trying to develop a chart where you can say Caliente gets really bad cabbage cluster caterpillar. So that depending on the time of year you want to grow it, it may not be all that suitable in summer because of the pest problem. Whereas most of them will get diamondback moth, some will get diamondback moth more than others. These are the ones which look like a broccoli leaf, where it's a blue-green foliage, waxy type texture. Some of these other ones are just plain green, hairy, which may be a detriment or deter the actual caterpillars from establishing. And we're trying to show that some varieties are better suited, like Nemat is a really good one. That the biggest problem that's going to get is aphids. It will get a lot of your other pests, but it's such at low numbers that it doesn't tend to affect the end result, which is what you want to get large biomass or get some biomass, get it through to flowering and then be able to incorporate a decent crop. So this is just showing the variability that you're going to get from variety to variety, and that might help you decide which one you can actually grow in your area depending on the pest pressure. We did the same with diseases. There's a lot of diseases that they can get from your bacterial brown rots, your soft rots, white blisters, and different types of mildews, your powdery and downy mildew. You also get phytoplasmas, and these are fairly sporadic. They'll come in, you might just see one or two plants in a paddock with that, and same with your viruses. You don't see a lot of these actually in your crop. And so again, we're trying to develop a table where you can pick and choose varieties according to the disease level. So your brassica juncias, they get a lot of cabbage cluster caterpillar, but they also get a lot of downy mildew. They may produce a lot of glucosinolates, but they seem to get a lot more pest and disease activity on them as well. So you just have to be mindful that if you're going to grow these crops, you can't just chuck them in the ground and walk away from them. You need to be checking them. You need to be monitoring for your pests and diseases. Because if you don't, as I showed in one of the earlier photos, you can quickly lose your crop. So you need to be looking at them all the time. Treat them like a cash crop, because that's what they are. They're saving you cash. If you're looking at it from a soil health benefit point of view, they're helping you control soil-borne pests and diseases. So they're saving you money and inputs to try and manage those particular problems.
John, I just got a question here regarding if you use a mixture of cover crops rather than just a single species, what Yep. impact do you think that would have on their susceptibility, particularly to insects, I suppose?
I guess if you're using mixtures rather than just straight brassicas, it could be harder for an insect to find them because they're looking between whether it be a cereal or a legume or something else. You've got a lot less of that plant in the paddock. So with the mixtures, instead of a single species being 10 kilos per hectare, you may only be putting around about 1 kilo per hectare depending on how many varieties you have in your mix. So it could make it harder for your pests and diseases to actually find them and cause any damage.
You had some mixes in the in your trials. Did you notice any differences?
The only issue with mixes, it depends a lot on what varieties you have in there. So with your BQ mulch, you've got a Brassica carinata, which is same as your cappuccino, and that variety is heavily attacked by insects. Same with your fungicide, that's got a brassica carinata. Those mixes where you've got varieties that resemble cabbage and broccoli, they're more susceptible to insect damage than any of the others. So there was a little bit of difference between commercially available varieties. So you just got to bear that in mind as well as to how susceptible the individual species are. And then if you've got a mix with those in them, you've got to just say, well, is it worth it?
I'll just add and broaden out that conversation is that, you know, once you start going into mixes, you start to run into more complex management problems because you might have different cover crops that flower and seed at different times. So, you know, obviously if you say you've got a buckwheat in there, it'll flower in 30 days. And so suddenly you've got that issue within your cover crop. If you've got a buckwheat in with something else that takes a lot longer. You know, obviously if you've got a mix, then like John said, there's less chance of those plants being found by the insect because often they'll fly over looking for colour changes. And if it's in a part of a mix, they might notice it, might not notice it. In terms of disease, there's mixed evidence about whether having it in a mix improves the disease resistance. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. So there are a lot of complexities once you go to mixes, and you know some of the benefits are not so clear. So you just got to be a little bit careful about what you're doing it, particularly for short-term cover crops. Here I'm talking about, you know, a couple of months, because a lot of times that the complexity of the mix won't be expressed. And what you'll find is if you've got four or five species in the mix, only, you know, probably two or three will dominate and outgrow. And if you don't leave it for a longer period of time, you know, the clovers might not come through or your legumes might not come through and they just get swamped by the sprinting cereals. So you do have to think about that. Like, you know, you'll probably look on the web and see lots of videos of people promoting 8, 10, 20 different species, but just be careful because a lot of times they're putting them into for a long period and they might even be grazing them. So they're almost putting a pasture in.
And I guess with your biofumigants, the mixtures that you can get, we've been playing around with three different mixtures. BQ mulch, which is one of the older varieties that have been commercially available for a number of years. The two species in that, one flowers within 36 days in summer, but the other variety or the other variety in that blend may not flower for another month. So when you're using that particular variety or any variety with mixtures in it, you need to incorporate it when the first species or that variety is flowering. You can't wait until the second one flowers, because as Kelvin said, the first one's already matured and those seed are going to germinate and cause you weed problems later on if that happens. So you have to plough them in when the first one's flowering.
We've got another comment there from Rob basically saying that won't some of those different species in your mix also host diseases? And I think that's a real issue that you've got to be very careful about when you're selecting your cover crops. You know, the last thing you want to do is make any soil-borne disease issues worse than what you've got. Selecting your cover crops so that you avoid ones that host it and make the disease issues worse.
Yes.
And again,
that's one of the reasons we're doing this.
And one of the things, you know, you're seeing some tables here. We're aiming to produce these tables in next year, and they'll be fairly comprehensive. So there'll be another list of, you know, your cereals, your legumes, and it'll have basically what sort of soil-borne diseases they host or don't host, and the same with nematodes. So you'll have a selection of tables as a lookup, and they're really meant to be a starting point to say, you know, if there's some red bits like John's got on his table, then you know you want to be avoiding those ones if that's an issue for you. So for example, if Sclerotinia is an issue, then you want to be avoiding a certain cover crops so you're not making it worse.
John, just one more question. Did you see any differences between pest and disease incidents between the seasons, between summer and winter?
Good question. I've got so much data, I haven't really analysed everything, but I think you do get a lot more in summer than in winter. Conditions are, especially for your mildews, the downy mildew, which is what I wasn't expecting, was more of an issue during the warmer months than compared to the winter months. So there was a slight difference from time of the year. And that's, I guess that's something that we need to actually go back and just pay a bit more attention to that. And maybe even the table that we had, look at, splitting that up, comparing summer and winter. And just so that you can then decide if you've got a summer period, then don't choose that particular variety. If you've got a winter period, then maybe that's going to be better.
John, but in summary, you'd say that the pest pressure was greater over summer than winter?
Yep, pest pressure certainly was.
And would you, I mean, there are a lot of soft chemical options to control some of those. Is that what you think that would be necessary?
We've just incorporated some Caliente yesterday as part of a trial we're looking at. We sprayed that once for caterpillar activity, and that was against cabbage cluster caterpillar. And that took, I think it was about 45 days from planting to flowering. So we had to spray that only once for caterpillars.
Yeah.
Some varieties that are longer, you may need to put more applications on depending on the particular pest issue you're going to get, especially those ones that come in plague proportions like your red shoulder beetle or even your Rutherglen bugs, where you might need to spend a little bit more effort in trying to manage them. There are a lot of soft options for caterpillars like your BTs, but again, timing is critical when you actually use some of these products. So it will vary depending on the pest, yeah.
But probably what we should really be clear on here, when you're growing a biofumigant, you're growing it for the biofumigant action. And
yep.
You know, in that case, you might need to invest a bit more time and energy in getting a good crop to get that good ITC hit. And so, like normally for cover crops, you wouldn't be thinking about spraying them. You'd be trying to avoid things that host pests and diseases. But here, the benefits that you might get from the biofumigation might justify a bit more interventions in terms of pesticides. And yeah. I guess what John said earlier was, you know, treat it like a cash crop.
Yeah. So we'll move into the soil management side of things. And some of you have probably seen this, something similar before. Inside your plant, you've got your glucosinolates and an enzyme, and they're traditionally separated, but when you macerate the crop, so you pulverize it, as you can see here, this is very well pulverized material, they come into contact. They then start chemical reaction producing your isothiocyanates or ITCs. And it's at that stage where you need to incorporate them into the ground. You can see a difference, and this is using a rotary hoe. From mulching to incorporating, you want to get it buried in as quickly as you can so that you get the maximum benefit from that chemical reaction. And it's that chemical that is toxic to a whole range of soil-borne pests and diseases. And that will help with some disease suppression. We, over the last number of years, have been looking at three main soil-borne diseases. You've got your sclerotinia rocea, which causes a basal rot. It's generally a summer problem. Then your sclerotinia, you've seen that a lot in lettuce, but it also attacks a whole range of other crops, and that likes a cool climate. And then macrophomina, which is, again, another summer problem, ashy stem blight or charcoal rot, especially a lot in legumes and cereals. So these are the three that we've been playing with over the number of years, looking at how the different varieties perform against these particular soil-borne pathogens. And in order to do that, what we normally do is rear these pathogens in the lab, get the resting bodies or the propagules that they produce. We then bury them in the soil at incorporation in little bags and see how effective the gas or the fumigation effect has had on their survival. And it's that's what we'll quickly touch on today. So,
John, so just to reiterate that, you're burying the resting structures. They can be quite resistant to or quite sturdy in terms of being able to survive. So they're quite a good test in terms of picking this up. So basically, if you can get mortality in those, if you can kill those off, then you're going to kill a lot of the, let's say if it's a fungus, the mycelium off, you're going to kill that off. If you're killing the resting bodies off, you're going to kill the mycelium off.
Yes. Now, be mindful that our soils are high in organic matter. This is for Sclerotium rossii, this first graph. And you can see the Brassica juncias outperformed most other varieties. And even our fallow had moderate effect at different times of the year. So we looked at, had three different plantings we assessed. So you've got late spring going into summer, an autumn planting, and then midwinter going into spring. The midwinter seems to be better than autumn in for a lot of these, apart from your tillage radish, where an autumn planting gave us better control than either a summer or a spring planting.
So John, just in terms of the graph there, you've got mortality percent there. Obviously, you would like 100%, so you're killing off the particular southern rot in this case. So the bigger the bar, the better.
Yeah, the bigger the bar, the better. And you can see with even within a variety, you're getting differences at different times of the year. Now, remember that in an earlier graph where we talked about total glucosinolates, you do get a lot more, especially from the Brassica juncias being produced when it's cooler compared to summer. This is an effect here. The BQ mulch, you get a lot better, even though it's only up to 23 or 22% mortality, you're getting a better response in summer compared to winter. So different varieties perform differently at different times of the year. And you do get a lot of variability between varieties, as you can see here. We did grow a sorghum. We started off with fumigator, now the new one is scavenger. So we did compare that with the others. And you can see that its performance against this particular pathogen wasn't all that crash hot. In fact, it was worse than fallow.
Yeah, and it's always important to point out the fallow, because fallow is traditionally a very good control measure for soil-borne diseases. Yep. So as a rule of thumb, I always look for things, cover crops that are as good as or better than your fallow. Because if you can get as good as fallow, then you're going to get reasonable control, but you're getting the added benefit of adding inorganic matter to just to bolster your soil health at home.
Absolutely.
Just a couple of questions I got here, John, before you go on to the next one is, in terms of the whole, just the process of incorporating your biofumigants, there's a question about how fast you've got to do it. And also, so are we talking minutes, hours, days in terms of quick incorporation? And then what's the impact of just mulching it and leaving it on the surface without incorporating?
The faster the better. You can't leave it for hours before you incorporate it after mulching. The ITCs are very volatile. They will evaporate very quickly. So the quicker you can get it into the ground, the better. I would be looking at, if you can manage within 30 minutes, the best. Ideally, if you've got a tractor where you have the mulcher on the front and the rotary hoe or cultivation equipment on the back so it does it in one pass, that is by far the best option. But not every grower's got that kind of equipment. The grower that I was talking to last week, there was two of them. So one was mulching and the other was coming in behind with a hoe and ploughing it in. So they were getting it in very quickly. So the longer you leave it on the ground, the less chemical you're actually going to get in, actually going in there. And I guess that leads to that second question about whether you can mulch it and just leave it on the ground. We haven't done any work in that area. And I know one researcher was asking the same question, whether you mulch it, irrigate it to try and get the chemical into the ground, whether that is an option. We haven't looked at it. It may work. I just don't know.
I mean, I have heard of people doing that in terms of just applying it as a mulch, and it does have some impact. But again, you've got to water it in a bit. But obviously, it's fairly low concentration, so the impact is not that great. But you can get some residual effect, if you like, and having a mulch there.
It won't go right into the soil either. You may only get it in the top. No, maybe 10 centimetres, if that, 5 to 10 centimetres. And it won't last there either. It won't stay there for a long time. Mm. So.
And a follow-up question from that is, are there glucosinolates in the roots? And I'll just answer it. Yes, there are. They're different profile to what you get in the leaf. But if you do cultivate them up, you will release it. And they are being released all the time anyway as root senescence and that. So, you know, that's part of the thing of growing a brassica. We know they're a good break crop. That's where it came from broadacre. And, you know, recognising the value in having a brassica into their rotations. John, we're going to have to keep moving.
Okay.
We've got too many questions, which is great to have. But
okay. So I'll quickly go through the other pathogens that we're playing with. We found that a summer planting of most varieties, even our fallow, we still got very good control of sclerotinia in summer. There are some varieties that perform very poorly. Yeah, Brassica napus is two varieties that just did not do very well. And again, your scavenger or your sorghum did not perform very well. So this is a summer planting compared to the cooler time of the year, your autumn, late winter, spring. You get a lot better response in summer with this pathogen with a lot of varieties. Now, be mindful that our fallow, even though it's high, we have our soils are fairly high in organic matter and most likely high in microbial activity as well. So our soils have some suppressive activity. So you just have to be mindful of that.
Yeah. So just to add a bit more to that, then your fallow, you've basically got a lot of the fungi that would predate on these resting bodies of sclerotinia. So, you know, that's the mechanism and the biofumigants adding to that. And also just feeding some of those saprophytic fungi, and then they are attacking the sclerotia of these things. But it's interesting that for the two diseases, they're different profiles in terms of when the efficacy is so great or better.
That's two. And when you look at the third one, you get a different response again. Our fallow is still giving us some effect. Some of these varieties, especially growing in late winter, spring, gave us even better effect. So your nemat and your tillage radish are far better than most other varieties of biofumigants against this particular pathogen. So you can see that not every variety is going to have the same effect against every pathogen or soil-borne pathogen. And we're trying to nut some of that out. What variety works best against what disease and at what time of the year. So we're creating yet another table, looking at different times of the year, your different pathogens, all your varieties, and trying to build some sort of matrix where you can then pick and choose a variety for your particular soil-borne disease problem and then match that against your pests and diseases that you're likely to get on those varieties. We do wish to try and expand the number of pathogens that we're looking at, and we do have some early data which I haven't presented today on verticillium wilt, your rhizoctonia, and even white rot, but I haven't presented that today because we're still collating it, but we would like to expand on that table to give you more options.
I'm just going to try and quickly say some of the questions, which I think some of them we have asked or answered. One of them does talks about the different diseases at different times of the year, and I think we've shown that you've got to select which disease your focus is on. So if it's after Sclerotinia, then it's totally different to if it's a southern rot. You know, you've got to look at which one is the main issue for you. There's another question around about the impact on the disease. So, you know, you've got the sclerotia that you've buried in the soil and looked at efficacy against those. I don't think you've done any follow-up plantings to see what the impact is on the crop.
No, not yet.
It's so we have done some of that in southern Taz, looking at sclerotinia. There wasn't a biofumigant in the trial. We had mainly cereals, and the oats and the millet cereal showed a reduction in sclerotinia in the following lettuce crop. So basically, the cereals don't host sclerotinia, and so they form quite a good break crop, and we showed that it was a reduction in it. Now, we weren't quite sure whether it was due to just general improvements in the soil physical condition, so it was less prone to it, or it was because we couldn't see any real reduction in the levels of sclerotinia in the soil prior to the lettuce crop. So, you know, it gets complicated trying to work out why it actually reduced the level. One last question. Do you think the glucosinolates can control the pathogen on infected crop debris? So, yeah, it's a good one in terms of, if you've got lettuce left over, you'll have sclerotinia growing on that. Obviously, trying to reduce your pest or your disease loading in any way you can is really good. So trying to manage your residues of your crop so that you don't allow those fungus to just run away and produce lots of scleros is a good opportunity, because more scleros you have, the more pressure you've got.
And one of these pathogens, the macrophemina, and to an extent some of the other ones we're just looking at, we actually grow them on millet seed. So each seed will have large numbers of infection propagules or microsclerotia. And so they're the things that we bury and then plate them out after a week in the soil to see what effect the biofumigation action has had. So, and I guess in a roundabout way, I would say yes, that can, some varieties may be able to help control your pathogen on your residue, but it could depend a lot on varieties and species. Yeah.
John, we're going to have to wrap this up, but there was one question earlier, and that was regarding, just the volatility of the ITCs, how long they stick around for, the conditions that are more conducive to getting a kill from them.
Yep, they are very volatile. Some of the literature says even after 48 hours, there shouldn't be much left in the soil. So the quicker you can get it in, the better. If it's left on top, then even within a few hours, most of those ITCs would have evaporated. So it's not going to stay around for very long.
But there is a general rule of thumb is plant back is around about 2 weeks after incorporation. And there have been examples of where the crop that has been planted too early has had mortality. So yeah, they can stick around. The other thing is where people can get caught is if you incorporate and the soil's a bit dry, you won't actually get the release of the ITCs until you get water on it. So that sort of plant back time can be extended out. And that's, for example, you can buy biofumigants as pellets. So where they basically harvested the crop, pelletized it, dried it, pelletized it, and then you can basically broadcast it, incorporate it, and add water, and it'll still produce that ITC. John, you might want to comment on that little trial that you've got in regarding that.
The incorporation one you're talking about.
Well, I'm just thinking where we're looking at spraying it out and leaving it to desiccate.
One of the things that came up from a number of growers is if you can't get onto to incorporate the crop, whether it be because of weather conditions or maybe you just don't have the time, we're looking at spraying the plant or the spraying the crop off with Roundup, so desiccating it. So once you have got the time to plow it in, we're actually looking at whether you're still going to get glucosinolates in that dry material. In theory, we should, because when we harvest our plants, we'll dry them, grind them, and put them in the fridge, and then use that dry material to do our lab work or pot trials. So this wouldn't be that much difference from spraying the crop out, letting it dry out, and then incorporating it, and still getting the same benefit as you would if you plowed it in fresh. That's still early days, and I'm hoping that it will work. It may help growers a lot in being able to put it in when they can. So I guess I'm mindful of time. Yeah, we're going to have to wrap up. So just in summary, they can be grown over summer periods, which is outside the winter grown season. They're much faster to flowering in summer. 36 days is the shortest we've come across so far, which is BQ mulch and some of your Junceas. And different varieties produce different amounts of biomass, different amounts of glucosinolates. The results generally show a higher efficacy against some of the soil-borne pathogens we've been looking at over summer, so you get a better effect in summer compared to winter. Different varieties are susceptible to different rain or different types of pests and diseases. So we're hoping that you can pick and choose a variety for your location, for your particular pest and disease or soil-borne pest and disease problem, knowing that you're going to have to put some inputs into it or at least monitoring it to see whether you need to control any other insect pests that they get. So. And thanks to everyone that's contributed to this work so far. We've had a swag of people, and even the seed companies have been very generous in supplying a lot of varieties for the work that we've been doing. So,
well, thank you, John. The webinar has been recorded, so will be available soon on the website. So just go to that Soil Wealth website, look for the cover crops and biofumigation tab under topics, and it'll be under there. You'll be able to go back and actually look at those tables and graphs with a bit more time. they are draft ones. They're obviously evolving, and we've got a whole lot more in preparation around agronomy and other soil-borne diseases. So that's sort of going to be the main output from the project that'll continue once we finish in June next year. So I'd just like to thank John for the presentation and all the hard work up there in the heat in Queensland.
Yeah, very hot.
and under trying conditions with the droughts up there at the moment, it's pretty grim in terms of water availability. So it's been quite challenging to run the trials. I'd just like to thank the participants for coming online. Most of you are still here, which is good to see. And more importantly, for all the questions you've put in, you've made us run a little bit over time, but that's just great interaction. So thank you for coming along.
Yep. Thanks for listening, guys.
Okay.
That's it. Cheers.